Ladies and gentlemen, as president of the Hague Institute for Global Justice, it is my pleasure to welcome you all to this distinguished speaker event. I am delighted that we tread new ground in our distinguished speaker series by welcoming former Prime Minister Jan-Peter Balkenende. Not only is Professor Balkenende the first former head of government to join us for the series since its launch 3 months ago, but he is in fact also the first Dutch speaker, emblematic of our Institute's desire to enjoy global reach, but also to remain grounded on the issues at the forefront of the agenda in Dutch and European foreign policy. Our aim in presenting such esteemed speakers to audiences here in The Hague is to engage its diverse community of policymakers, business leaders, and academics in dialogue with world-renowned leaders, thinkers, and practitioners, and thereby to elucidate the Hague Institute's own work on conflict prevention, the rule of law, and global governance, with commentary from leading experts in international affairs. Jan-Peter Balkenende is a foremost authority on these and many other topics. Not only is he one of the longest-serving prime ministers in Dutch history, and one of the most recognizable European politicians of the past decade, but he now continues his work on global challenges through his work on sustainability. It is heartening that the Rio+20 conference identified the need for a series of sustainable development goals that would sit alongside the post-2015 agenda. The challenge now is to ensure complementarity between these processes and to ensure that political will is in place. Such challenges require the expertise of those who have navigated the highest levels of the international policy process. As Professor Balkenende's role at Ernst & Young, and indeed his work chairing the Dutch Sustainable Growth Coalition emphasizes, sustainable solutions will also require new partnerships between government, business, and civil society. I am pleased that we are joined today by other representatives of the Dutch business community, including experts in corporate social responsibility, which will no doubt make for a fascinating discussion. I am also very glad that Professor Balkenende's remarks today will focus on the relationship between sustainability and global justice, which is emerging as an essential paradigm for contemporary international relations. Sustainability has implications for a variety of global justice issues, including the right to development and the relationship between the global North and South. On behalf of the Institute, I would like to bid a very warm welcome to Professor Balkenende, and indeed to all those who have joined us this afternoon. I very much look forward to the discussion today. I now invite you, Prime Minister, to take the stage.
Mr. President, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's great to be here in this beautiful building, and it's great to be here in the legal capital of the world. And that's the way we describe the city of The Hague. The beautiful buildings, the Peace Palace, so important for the city. The Hall of Knights, the political center of the Netherlands. The Mauritshuis, we have a fantastic collection. Also, you have the official residence of the Dutch Prime Minister. That's called the Catshuis. And maybe it's good to start with a nice story about the Catshuis. In 1992, on the 21st of February, I defended my PhD thesis at the Free University. And later in the evening, we had a dinner. And my father was always interested in history. And he discovered that the Catshuis in the 17th century was built by a city architect, Stadstimmerman. And the name was Klaas Dirksson van Balkenende. That was nice. And so my father made the remark. He said, once there has been a Balkenende who built the Catshuis, now it's time that the Balkenende will live in the Catshuis. It was a great remark. And we had a lot of fun, but 10 years later, indeed, it was my residence. It's a nice story. Thank you very much, Mr. President, for inviting me to give a speech, contribution about sustainable development and global justice. I don't have slides or a PowerPoint presentation, but it does not mean that it has no content. And that reminds me of the British television series, Yes Minister and Yes Prime Minister. You probably know this series. And maybe you've seen that one item. Then the Prime Minister received a draft speech. And he read the speech, the draft speech, and he reread it. And then he said to his advisor, but it has no content. And the advisor replied, thank you for the compliment, Prime Minister. I intend to speak about three items. First, I would like to make some general remarks about global justice. My second point is about sustainable development as the guiding principle for the public and private sector. And the third component is about the necessity for taking action. That's what I intend to do. These are my three points. Do you agree with these three points? Yes? No suggestions? You're satisfied? Okay, thank you very much. This was the moment of interaction in my speech. First, global justice. Let's go back to the year 1965. In that year, Dr. Martin Luther King received an honorary doctorate at the Free University in Amsterdam. And first, we had an official event. And then he went to the students, to a student organization of the Free University. And he said to the students, I hope we can speed up that glad day that all of God's children, white men and black men, Protestants and Catholics, Muslims and Hindus, Jews and Gentiles, all of God's children, will walk hand in hand, singing the old spiritual, free at last, thanks God Almighty, we are free at last. A fantastic remark, but if you analyze the words of Martin Luther King, it's about three components. The first is freedom. Different religions, everyone has the right to have his own belief or conviction, even the non-believers. The second point, walk hand in hand, is a matter of working together, cooperation, responsibility. And the words free at last says a lot about human dignity. I think it's a very inspiring message. And of course, talking about freedom, that's related to the four freedoms of President Roosevelt, as pointed out in his State of the Union in 1941. The freedom of worship, the freedom of speech, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. So Martin Luther King, in my life, was always a very inspiring person. The same counts for Mahatma Gandhi. He had clearly defined convictions. He knew what has to be done. But he always said that it must be realized without violence. He believed in the strength of convictions. And he said, if you have your convictions in the beginning, the others will ignore you. And then they will laugh about you. And then they will fight you. But in the long run, you will win. The power of the clearly defined convictions. It's also a good one. A third man I would like to mention, that's Nelson Mandela. When you've been so long in prison, and when you're free, and when you have the courage to talk about the new South Africa, not an apartheid regime the other way around, but really a new South Africa, on the basis of reconciliation, then you really inspire people. And I think the message of Martin Luther King, of Gandhi and Mandela, of course, has to do with values and global justice. Because it is about human rights. It's about democratic rights. It's about income distribution, about poverty. It's also today about climate change. It's about Millennium Development Goals. All these things are related to global justice. We have the ideals, the views, the convictions. But what? In daily life. Let me also give some examples. A few years ago, I was invited to come to Singapore to attend the conference of Temasek. That's a big investing company. And I had the honor to be seated beside Lee Kuan Yew, the great man of Singapore. And we talked about financial developments, and we talked about China. And I said, what's your opinion about China? He started by saying that the country did a fantastic job to get so many people out of poverty. That is achievement. But at the same moment, he said, I have two concerns. One is corruption, And the second is inequality. Inequality between the people in the coastal area and the hinterland, but also in the coastal area itself. And it's good to be honest about what are the difficult developments. But yesterday you heard about Europe, an investigation of the European Commission. And it was also about corruption in Europe. And Mr. President, then we talk about inequality. I listened carefully to what President Obama said in Washington. That's also about inequality in the US. So the issues around corruption and inequality have a global dimension. We have to be honest about it. Another point that concerns me is violence. I mentioned Mahatma Gandhi. I think the international community waited too long after what we've seen in Syria. Thousands of people are being killed. That's the story. My last conference that I attended in my capacity as Prime Minister was a meeting between heads of government from Asia and European governments. And the Prime Minister of Malaysia made, I think, an important remark. He said, we need a coalition of the moderates. And I agreed with him, because the extremists will never work on finding solutions. You must have a coalition of the moderates. And then another observation. Last year, I read a book that was called Why Nations Fail. Maybe you've read it. Why Nations Fail is the result of a 14 or 15 years research project of two professors, one from Harvard, the other from MIT, Otsumoglu and Robinson. And the interesting question in the book Why Nations Fail is, what are the conditions under which countries will be successful or not? And the recommendation is very clear in that book of Otsumoglu and Robinson. They say, if a country wants to be successful, it depends on issues around innovation, room for creative destruction, working on doing new things. It's about the rule of law and property rights, but it's also about equality, that people can have part on the fruits of economic development, the development of middle class, upward mobility, etc. And he said the opposite of an inclusive institution is an extractive institution. An extractive institution means that if you have the revenues, but these revenues go into the pockets of an elite, a capitalist elite, a communist elite, doesn't matter. So he said inclusive institutions are necessary to develop in the right direction. I must say, I read it in Malta. That's our favorite holiday destination. So it was fantastic to read this book, and I can recommend it to you. Maybe a word about Malta. It's our favorite holiday destination. And who have visited Malta? The few of you, you know it. You have the Isle of Malta, you have a small Isle of Gozo, and a small one that's Comino. What happened? Our daughter, she was on the primary school, and the classmate was on the Isle of Gozo. We were on Malta. And I said, oh, let's rent a car, and we go to the Isle of Gozo. So we had a fantastic meeting over there. And then I said, but we must have the ferry of 5:15, otherwise you are a bit late for the dinner. And if you miss the ferry, then you have to wait for an hour. And what happened, we were there, I think, 5:10. There was a white line, and I already saw that the ferry was almost filled up with cars. And suddenly, there were two cars before me, and there was the third one, and there was a blue Peugeot. It was passing us, and that went to the boat, to the ferry. And the two people in front of me, they were furious and were using the klaxons. And then the man who organized the traffic said, priority, priority. Well, what happened? These two cars were allowed to go to the ferry and you had to wait for an hour. Right. And then I asked the man, you said something about priority. What do you mean by priority? He said, you mean the blue Peugeot? Yes, I mean the blue Peugeot. Oh, that was the Minister of Culture. Then I said, but excuse me, do you know who I am? I'm the Prime Minister of the Kingdom of the Netherlands. And then he started laughing and he said, all people are equal. Now, I think that was also, let's say, an example of global justice. So global justice, you have to view the ideals, I mentioned them. In practice, you see difficulties. But let me mention the third point in this section of the presentation. That is about some observations. And I will mention two reports. The first is the Edelman report. That's called the Trust Barometer. And since 2001, Edelman is investigating the factor trust in societies. A remarkable outcome this year is that there is really a gap in trust between business and government. The respondents say that there's a gap already of 20% in trust between governments and businesses, and in some countries even 40%. So people, and more than 80% of respondents is saying, we believe that companies are able to pursue their own self-interest at the same moment that they can contribute to society. A new view on the role of businesses. And then the authors are writing, if a company is doing the right things, it's a matter of participate. If you are talking about your business strategy, the goals of your business, talk with NGOs, talk with governments, talk with others about what you want to achieve. And then define your key performance indicators, your strategy. And when you've pointed out your strategy, then it's a matter of stick to it. That's what you call advocate. Talk with your critical actors in society. Be honest about it. And the third component is evaluate. Be honest about results. Clarify when things are going in the right direction, but also explain why things are not going the right direction. And then the authors are writing, when we talk about the role of business today, it's also about having an external orientation. That's an important one. And it's about an orientation in which you can find solutions for those issues that are on the global agenda today. And one step further, that has to do with, let's say, the capitalist system. The authors are saying, we can see a change from the traditional, transactional character of capitalism towards another model. Another model, and that's about value creation. And then you can see the combination of doing the right things for society and at the same moment you have to obey the rules of, let's say, the shareholders. A combination of doing business in the right way, but that should be linked with the issue around sustainability issues. That was the message of the Trust Barometer. And it reminds me of Adam Smith. You know, Adam Smith is the founder of modern economic thinking. And Adam Smith is well known because of his book, The Wealth of Nations, an inquiry into the cause of the wealth of nations. And everybody's saying that is about the invisible hand in the economy. And when we had the Industrial Revolution in the 19th century and the social issues of those days, people say, ah, that is the invisible hand. But we've forgotten that 10 years before he wrote the book, The Wealth of Nations, he wrote the book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. So for Adam Smith, the invisible hand was always connected with the issue of the moral sentiments. And today you can see more and more the conviction that if you talk about market economies, it should be linked to these moral aspects, ethics and economy. That brings me to my second report I would like to mention. That is the Global Risks Report of the World Economic Forum. And it's very clear in their analysis of the global risks of today. Risk with highest concern has to do with financial crisis in key economies. That's number one. The second is a structurally high unemployment and underemployment. Water crisis, the third one. The fourth one is about a severe income disparity. And the fifth is a failure in climate change mitigation adaptation. When they talk about the risk, it has to do with issues around sustainability, climate change, energy, etc. It's a very clear analysis, but it's more than that. The authors of this report are also describing that we can see imbalances at a global scale. You can see national self-interest, and they even talk about the risk of a global governance vacuum. The second point they are mentioning that has to do with unemployment of young people in developing countries and in developed countries. And there's a risk of a lost generation. And the third item they mentioned that has to do with the whole world of internet. Digital disintegration, as they mention it, because there are a lot of risks. And the conclusion of the authors is that there are a lot of risks today with a long-lasting and far-reaching consequence. And the end of the report also talks about what should be done today And they mention four common components. First, it is about trust. You have to restore trust, otherwise you can forget it. That's the first one. The second one, that has to do with a long-term orientation. We are talking about the hypes, what's in the media today, next election, etc. They said, no, we must have a long-term orientation. The third component has to do with collaborative, multi-stakeholder actions. Businesses, governments, NGOs, they have to work together to find the solutions for the issues that are so important today. And the fourth component, that has to do with global governance. Because if you talk about climate change or cybersecurity, you cannot solve these issues as a nation. You need each other. So you must also organize the global governance in the right way. I think these are very important observations. So global justice, it's an orientation. You can analyze the world of today, but also you have to be aware of the risks. And I think you must have an honest analysis in order to find solutions. This brings me to my second point. Mr. President, I'm in time. No problem at all. You give a warning, okay? So you know, there's always a risk when politicians, but I'm not a politician anymore, when they have microphones, they cannot stop talking. There's a solution for that. Not so long ago, maybe you heard it, I was invited to give a speech for 1,000 employers, entrepreneurs, in Hoofddorp, a city near Schiphol Airport. And then the technician, he gave me the headset and also the battery. And then he said, Mr. Balkan, the battery will work for 20 minutes. That's the first solution. The second is never give a glass of water to the speaker. That's a natural limit for speaking time. And if you're really getting bored, just start applauding and never stop applauding, then it's also over. These are the solutions. Okay, my second point. Sustainable development. Mr. President, you talked about my political career and what I've done. What I noticed is that when I started my first political activity, that was in the city of Amstelveen, a city near Amsterdam, and I became secretary of a working group on development cooperation. That was my first political activity, development cooperation. My first activity, when I started working as a staff member of the think tank of my political party, for the Christian Democrats, that was writing a report about world economy and development. And when I became prime minister, my first international conference was in Johannesburg, and it was the World Summit on Sustainable Development. Always, I was engaged with issues around development, because it has to do with quality of life in the longer run. And you have to think globally. And now I would like to make some remarks about sustainability and what you can see. First, some observations. In my work now at EY, I have a fantastic job as partner corporate responsibility, and it is also good to work at a global company because you have colleagues everywhere in the world. You can talk about issues around sustainability. What's happening everywhere? What about business models? How can you change the work of the auditors, the tax advisors, and so on? It's fascinating. In the time when I was prime minister, I went to Japan, my first example. I spoke with a lot of private companies over there. And what I noticed is that a lot of companies were talking about the question, what are the values of our company? And among many of them, I saw that sustainability is one of those values. But they also considered sustainability not as a hindrance for doing business, but as a business driver. That was interesting. When I attended South Korea, and you know, South Korea is a country with a winning mentality. If you would have said, I like cars. 10 years ago, if you would say, I drive a Korean car, people say, oh, you're crazy. And today, quality has changed completely. 7-year guarantee, nice design, etc. That's what you can see today. A country with a winning mentality, but it's also remarkable, that country is talking about the component of green growth. Because they know if you want to be successful, it's always the combination of innovation, entrepreneurship, and sustainability. When I was in Singapore, I joined the launch of a new center that was called the Stewardship and Corporate Governance Center of Temasek. I mentioned that company already. And I spoke with the director. I said, why do you have a Stewardship and Corporate Governance Center? And the answer was, our directors are taking decisions every day on investments. But every director must be able to have the right connection between the investment decisions on the one hand and the issue of sustainability on the other hand. It's interesting that the investing company is talking about integrating sustainability in your models of decision making. Last year I was in Africa. I attended the conference of my company, EY. And during a long time, we were talking about the difficulties of the African continent. And when I was there, I heard that you can find the highest growth figures in Africa. It's remarkable. There was an investigation about the integration of sustainability in business models, and in fact, the African continent at the moment is leading because a lot of companies know that they should be active in this field. Because sometimes you have a poor quality of government, so it's up to you as a company to do the right things for society. In the United States, you have two tendencies. The traditional one is the following. When I joined my company, and said, oh, that's nice, you've been prime minister, and now you are part of corporate responsibility. We do a lot in the sphere of corporate responsibility. And then I said, may I ask you, what are you doing? And the answer was, we give money to charity. And of course, there's nothing wrong with giving money to hospitals, cancer research, etc. But the question is, of course, how do you realize your profits? And also, you can find other tendencies. Let me give the example of Ray Anderson. Maybe you heard his name. Ray Anderson was a very successful businessman. And he had a star carpet factory. And he was extremely successful. He realized huge profits. But after 20 years, he received an invitation to give a speech, a presentation about his results. And that was the moment that he said, from a business point of view, I'm doing the right things. My profits are okay, no problems at all. But have I asked myself the question, how have I realized my profits? Have I been thinking about energy efficiency, human rights, CO2 emissions? No. And that was the moment that he said, I have to rethink my own business model. That's also what you can see. So worldwide, you can see that there is a discussion about sustainability. When we talk about sustainability, I think the definition is already clear. We have the UN principles on human rights, the UN principles on sustainable investing, the UN principles on sustainable insurance, the guidelines of the OECD, the ISO criteria, the Global Reporting Initiative. In all these sets of criteria and standards, you will see that sustainability is about climate change and environmental issues. It's about energy, energy efficiency, the renewables. It's about human rights. It's about transparency and integrity. It's about your relationship with the society and your employees. And it's about financial sustainability. You can find all these criteria in all these documents. There's also another thing that's important to underline. When we talk about the role of business today, it is not the wording of Milton Friedman. In 1970, Milton Friedman said, the business of business is business. So, of course, you have to respect the rule of law, you have to act in a polite way, but the business of business is business. And today we have another management guru, Michael Porter, and he says it's about creating shared value. You must be able to show that you can deliver economic value and at the same time, you have to deliver social value by addressing the needs of society. So that's a new view on the role of businesses, creating shared value, that's the one. The second point is, a company never can act alone. You have to work together with others. That's the world of the new alliances. Forms of cooperation with governments, civil society organizations, etc. New alliances. And the third component is about long-term thinking. Let me give an example. I see also Johan de Koning, a good friend, and he's working at the Unilever company. Paul Polman, he said, I will stop with quarterly reporting because I won't have a situation in my company that the focus is more long-term oriented. And if I take away that symbol of quarterly reporting, that gives room to other orientation in my company. And of course, Paul Polman knows that he must be able to show results. Otherwise, he can forget his job. But it is the mindset of working, having a long-term orientation. So long-term thinking, new alliances, creating shared value. What you also can see is that it's not only a matter of having the right intentions, it's also a matter of being practical and honest about what do you want to realize. And that is the world of key performance indicators. When you talk about energy efficiency, what do you really mean and what do you want to reach? And when you want to bring down CO2 emissions, what are you doing? And what about human rights? So it's a matter of key performance indicators. During the process, you have the life cycle analysis. That means that you must be able to show what has been the dimension of sustainability and the whole chain of activities. And at the end of the whole process, of course, you have the issue of reporting. And that's a matter now of integrated reporting, the combination of financial performance and social performance. You have to integrate these elements. It's good to underline this issue of the quantitative aspects, and it's more than that. A few years ago, I had a meeting with Stiglitz, Professor Stiglitz, a Nobel Prize winner. And he is not satisfied with the way in which we define the gross domestic product. He said, we have to take into account sustainability issues, otherwise we are not delivering the right figures. And today, more and more, you can see there's another discussion. It's called the valuation of the corporation. What is the real value of a company? And if you do not take into account the cost of sustainability, you are not measuring in the right way. And there's also another initiative for young people here in the Netherlands called True Price. True Price means if you are not working, having the right price for a product, that means you are transferring costs to next generations or to others. Puma is a front runner, you know, the manufacturer of sports shoes. They are talking about what is the true price of a product. So the quant element is more and more important. Then, ladies and gentlemen, there has been a time that people said, well, there was attention for CSR, but when the economy went down, then the attention faded away. Today, more and more, you can see the opposite. Let me give a concrete example. When I was in New York, and you know New York very well, we attended a restaurant that was a kind of nice meeting to thank all the staff members of the embassy at the United Nations. We had a fantastic meeting over there, and there was a Dutch manager. I said, hey, that's remarkable. Your restaurant is new. The name of the restaurant was the Rouge Tomate, the red tomato. And then I said, since how long do you exist? It was in 2009. He said, we started 1.5 years ago. I said, 1.5 years ago? That means you started your restaurant in the time that the financial crisis started in New York. Many restaurants are suffering today. They have difficulties, not enough clients. And I said, but we have chosen for another formula. We consider ourselves as a sustainable restaurant. That has to do with the quality of the food, the way the wines are being produced, energy efficiency, etc. So this was a kind of new business model, and sustainability was also a business driver. Today, there's more and more evidence that if you are integrating sustainability in your business model, that it can be very profitable. First, Eccles of Harvard Business School, he did an investigation among 180 companies, 90 what he calls high sustainability companies, and 90 low sustainability companies between 1993 and 2010. And the outcome was that the high sustainability companies had a higher return on investment and a better profile on the stock markets than the other ones. But recently there was an article in The Guardian in the UK, and there was a reference to 50 studies saying that you can do business on the basis of sustainability. So we need that type of creativity. So I'm happy with the definitions. I'm happy with the fact that the companies are considered to have another role in society, that we must be practical. It's not only a matter of having nice intentions, but also about measurement and reporting. It's about honesty. And you can do business with it. But the question now is, of course, what are the recent developments? What can you see in daily life? And then I think it's good to underline some points of concern. Last year, there was an investigation of UN Global Compact. You know, that's the business network of the United Nations. And in that report, the author said, when you are talking with business people, more and more it's a matter of frustrated ambition. The ambition is there, but you also can hear arguments in the sense of, it's not so easy. We started the project, but it has not really been integrated in our business model. It's not so easy to talk about the financial revenues when you talk about sustainability issues. There are some doubts. And these CEOs are also talking about the role of governments. And I think this is not what you should have. It's so important to have businesses that are active and take up their own responsibilities. And I'm not talking about the governments. When I heard this story, and these were critical remarks, I spoke about it with Peter Bakker, and you know he's the president of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, the former president of TNT. And he said, well, in any case, we've made progress during the last years. That means it's always difficult to realize more. But he said, I think we are on the right track, but you have to do much more. That brings me to another one. MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Sloan, together with the Boston Consulting Group, is making every analysis about the progress of CSR. And when you read the reports in 2010, 2011, 2012, it was in fact an optimistic story. Every year, the authors were able to see that there's progress. A good story. Last year, he said the tipping point is there. The business people are convinced that you can do business in a sustainable way. There is a business case. But last year, the end of last year, you could read something about the disconnect between thought and action. Some doubts about the realization of sustainability in your way of doing business. Also, you could see the difference between the walkers and the talkers. So that's another type of wording. And I think it's good to underline. We know what sustainability is all about. We know what the new business models are. And businesses, they have to act. When I met Ban Ki-moon, he said, we will never reach the Millennium Development Goals without the support of the private sector. And I agree with him. So we must have a vital private sector. Not a private sector that's working alone. You have to work together with governments and with civil society organizations. So the orientations are there, definitions are there, intentions are okay, but now is the question, what about action? And that brings me to my third and last point. Action. When we talk about the issues around sustainability today, it is a matter of doing things in other ways than in the past. And the question is, should we be? I mentioned now some critical remarks. But also, it's good to talk about the optimistic analysis. For example, Kishore Mahbubani, a famous professor from Singapore, he wrote the book, The Great Convergence. And he said, we must be honest because we can see so many positive developments. Human rights are improving. You can see more democratic developments. The poverty is going down in several parts of the world. Illiteracy is going down in many parts of the world. So these are also the good developments. And it's good to underline these points. It's also good to underline that we can talk about new business models, that we talk about the integration of sustainability in the way of doing business. We have beautiful examples. So these are the good things. But at the same moment, we also discover that there are some reasons for doubts. And I also mentioned these issues. Now the question is, what should be done? I think it's so important to be very practical. Let me give a first example. When I just started working at EY, I went to IKEA. And IKEA is an interesting company because they are talking about sustainability. What does it mean for your business model? They say we need cotton and wood. And the first question is, how are cotton and wood being produced? What is the role of children in the production? What about the role of women? What about sustainability issues in relation to environmental issues, energy, etc.? And you have to do much more. So it's a matter of mindset. What does sustainability mean for your business model and your way of acting? And it was very inspiring to me. And I think they are doing a lot of things. And I spoke with the sustainability officer and he said, no, I'm not satisfied. We have to realize much more. So it's good to say something about IKEA. Also, when I was prime minister, I had a nice experience. There are many ambassadors here. And you know how it works when you have a state visit. So I remember time very well that the king of Sweden and the queen of Sweden were in the Netherlands. You know the story, Frans and Mieke. We have some good friends from Rotterdam. You heard the story already. And what happened? There was a state banquet, and then you are dressed in a white tie, and then you receive these high decorations. So I received the Grand Cross from Sweden. And I was in a white tie with my decorations, with three stars, with the sash and the star. That was the Grand Cross. And I thought, well, Balkenende, you look very nice. You're well dressed. You can go to the state banquet. So, and then when I left my room in the small tower, the torentje in The Hague, then my advisor started laughing and they said, hey, Jan-Pieter, are you the IKEA employee of the week? That was... That's about IKEA. Let me now say something about, and you already mentioned that, Mr. President, about the Dutch Sustainable Growth Coalition. When I started working at my company, I received an invitation to have a breakfast meeting with Paul Polman of Unilever. And later on, we spoke with Feike Sibesma, the CEO of DSM. And then we said, it's remarkable that so many Dutch companies are very high on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index. Because all these companies are convinced that you have to integrate sustainability in your way of doing business. And then we said, let's combine forces. Dutch, why Dutch? Because the Dutch always have an international orientation. You will find Dutch business people everywhere in the world. And Frans de Voice is one example. Everywhere in the world, you'll find them. And the second element of Dutch is always the willingness to work together with others. We are the country of the polder model. These are two, I think, essential elements of being Dutch. And then we said, let's be honest, what are these companies doing? And that's really interesting to see what's happening. DSM, the chemical company, they are receiving prize of the United Nations because of their contribution to the World Food Programme. So they integrate the issue of food in their business model. AkzoNobel, also a chemical company, now the number one on the Dow Jones Sustainability Index. They say, and they are making coatings, paint. They say, color, change the life of people. But also, they have coatings that you can keep out the heat of the sun, and it means you need less energy for ecosystems. So they integrate the issue of energy with their business model and their products they're delivering. The Philips company. Philips traditionally sold bulbs, radios, television. Today, they are selling light because they are convinced that it's a matter of acting in a circular way. So now you can see that technical equipment stays at the company of Philips. They are selling the service of light, and it means after some time, they are using again their equipment to reuse it. And when Philips is active in China, they talk about the labor conditions of employees in China. So they integrate those components. Heineken, it's always nice to talk about beer, and I'm sure we will receive beer afterwards. It's always very critical when you talk about beer. Once I told a story about Heineken in Twente, the eastern part of the country, and I told an enthusiastic story about the way Heineken is producing beer in Africa, and then nobody reacted. All serious faces, Mr. Balkenende, we drink Grols. But what's happening? Heineken says, when we are active in Africa, and of course they want to increase their activities over there, it's also our responsibility to do more for the people over there. Practical issues like supporting mobile health centers, they are doing that. They are helping former sports people in their career after their sports career is over. But talking about their key business, they say in 2020, 60% of the grains needed for the production of beer must be produced locally. Why? Less transport, less environmental pressure, and more economic opportunities for the local farmers. It's a matter of integrating all these components in your own way of doing business. And then we said it's a matter of shape. Shape means thinking about business models, learn from each other, get new insights. It's a matter of share, talk about these issues with other companies, and also the small ones. And stimulate debate. That's the reason why we work together with the Dutch government, the European Commission, etc. World Economic Forum. Our second report was about corporate governance and leadership components. What's the role of the non-executive members of the board? What about remuneration? What about ownership within the company? What about the tone at the top? All these things are key. And now our third publication will be about innovation. That's what we're doing. This is the story of the big companies, but also you see among smaller companies, fantastic examples. Have you heard about Waka Waka? You have it? No, you should. Waka Waka, it's in my car. I forgot to take it with me because it's very nice to show it. Waka Waka is a facility to have light. So if you can charge it, you just lay it in the sun for 8 hours, and for 60 or 70 hours, you will have light. This instrument can play such an important role in other parts of the world. When we had the terrible developments in the Philippines. Quite recently, VS Company, RCY, we offered 1,000 of these Waka Waka to the people because they have light. Have you heard about Oat Shoes? Also nice. A startup, young people here in the Netherlands. They said, we have to rethink the way we are making shoes. So if you have used your shoes and the time is over, you just can throw them in the ground because it will all disappear. And in the shoes, there are some seeds, so some flowers will grow up. Isn't it funny? I mentioned you the example of the Naga Foundation. There are many parts in the world that it's dead ground. And you can, when it's raining, the rain will just disappear. And now, when you start initiative with digging, that means you can keep the water into the ground, and then you can get green areas again. And that's what you can see more and more. I can give many of these examples. There are so many possibilities. They're about small companies. In the Netherlands, we started the Dutch Sustainable Trade Initiative. That is about how is cotton being produced. What about sustainability in your business model? How can you work together? NGOs, knowledge centers, governments, etc. And we have the organization for the small companies, CSR Netherlands. All these things are so essential. And these are just Dutch examples, but you can mention also examples in other parts of the world. I was a few weeks ago in Japan. And you know, the Japan government is busy with issues around reforms. And one of the elements is agriculture reform. You see a lot of small farms in Japan. And the government says, no, we should change that. We should have bigger farms, but also to integrate sustainability in their way of producing things. And I think you can see the vitality. So that means that reforms is also a matter of using new views, integrating sustainability in business models, etc. And you can see many of these elements in the whole world. And this brings me to some concluding remarks. Because I have the impression that we can do so many things. Last year I also read another fantastic book of Peter Diamandis. Maybe you heard it. He was quite recently in the Netherlands. Peter Diamandis was involved in the second journey to the planet Mars. And Peter Diamandis said, it's so strange. In fact, we have the technical solutions for all the issues we can see today. Water, water quality, poverty, health, education. He said, we have the technical means to find solutions, but there is a lack of governance. We are not having the right governance structures to realize it. But his book is in fact optimistic. We can make the difference. We can bring forward the changes. But is there the willingness to do things another way? And this brings, Mr. President, to the role of your institute, the Hague Institute for Public Justice, for Global Justice. And Global Justice says so much about the rights of people, human rights, democracy, inequality, rights of women and children. And I think there's an obligation for every one of us to work on having a good society. And we're all connected. When there's a tsunami, you directly see what's happening elsewhere in the world. Nobody can say, I didn't know. No, we know what's happening in the world. We will have 9 billion people in 2050 or even more. If the whole world would have the same patterns of production and consumption as the United States, we would need 4 or 5 times the Earth. So we have an unsustainable character today of the business models and the way of production and consumption. We have to change it. And I think the human mind has so many possibilities. I'm convinced that we can find solutions for the issues that are on the global agenda today. But the question is there a willingness to make the difference? We have the techniques, we have the views, we have the ideals. And I think the challenging element today is to work on the base of your conviction. You have to work on having a good society. You have to work on global justice. We have the techniques to do things another way. We know what the role of businesses is today. And we should not wait. We should not wait. We are running out of time. And I really hope, Mr. President, that what we can see today in the world will lead to a new era of hope, to an age of responsibility. And I hope the outcome will be that all human beings will be able to say, we are free at last. Thank you very much.
Many thanks for your very stimulating remarks. I know that our audience will be eager to engage you in debate in the time that remains. And we have staff standing with microphones for the questions. But allow me to start the discussion going by asking a few questions. You mentioned at the outset that you've spent your entire career in and out of government on issues relating to global development and sustainability. How have your perspectives changed on this issue since you left government and entered the business world? And did anything surprise you about the approach taken by the private sector on this issue?
Does it work?
Yeah, I think you just have to move it up.
It works now, yeah. In your life, there are some what you can call red lines. And when I look to my political party, would say green lines. Doesn't matter. And for me, the key issue always has been, how can you work on the perspective of a responsible society? I never believed in a scheme that the government is responsible for the social goals and the private companies are only there for realizing profits and continuity. I never believed in that scheme. So a responsible society was in fact my guideline. And I worked on that basis when I was working at the think tank of my party, when I was in the second chamber, when I became prime minister. This is my conviction. And now I was always active in academia, universities. I wrote my PhD thesis and I became professor, part-time professor at Free University. And now I'm in the business sector. What I see more and more is that a lot of businesses are busy with long-term thinking, are talking about other business models, are not waiting for the role of governments. Whereas at the same moment, you can see that, especially in Western democracies, often it's about what's in the media today, what's in the news today, next elections, also the financial difficulties. So what I noticed is that among a lot of companies, you can see a much more long-term oriented focus. That's one. The second point is, there has been a time that people in the business sector said, well, that's the role of government. I made some references about that. I think private companies cannot wait. They have their own responsibility. So I think it's necessary that also governments in the West are talking about redefining their own role. The financial difficulties will be there. And it's not easy for people in politics. And especially why it's not easy, therefore, you must have the good cooperation with civil society and with the business sector. And you must there must be a willingness to define the longer-term goals. In this country, for example, it's a matter of keeping our feet dry. You know, more than one-third is below sea level. It's about talking about the economic vitality of the Netherlands when we are running out of the revenues of gas, for example. That's to do with your economic vitality. It's about the position of the Netherlands internationally. It's about the aging of the population, new demographic composition of our country. What does it mean? What about values in society in a plural world? I think these issues are key. So I would like to underline the fact that it's necessary to have a long-term agenda. And that's what I notice in any case among many companies. You can find in any case that long-term orientation.
You've emphasized the importance of cooperation between government, the private sector, civil society, if we're going to deal with the issues of sustainability. From your experience, which are the areas where it is easy for the private sector to cooperate with governments,
yeah,
and which areas are more difficult?
Let's be very practical. In the Eindhoven area in this country, we have a model of cooperation between knowledge centers, private companies and governments, the provincial and the local governments. And we call this form of cooperation triple helix. And this has to do with technical equipment. There's also with sustainability issues. So you can realize many things, that's one. Second point, you have to define in which sectors you're strong. The Netherlands is strong in the chemical sector. I mentioned DSM, AkzoNobel. We are strong in water and water management. You can realize things. We are very strong in agriculture. I remember the first time when I attended China, I spoke with the Prime Minister. He exactly knew everything about Wageningen University. And he made a nice remark. He said, you are the best and we are the biggest. Let's combine. So you're right. It's always important to underline in which sectors you're strong, because then you can make a progress.
And then another question is, how optimistic are you that sustainable solutions will be found? Because as wealth shifts to emerging economies, won't we face new record levels of consumption, which will raise major questions about the viability of the sustainability agenda.
Yeah, but that depends on the way we produce things. It has to do, as I said, with consumption patterns. And if you would like to copy, let's say, the traditional way of living in the West, you will never find the right solution. It has to do with the redefinition of business models. It has to do with delivering other products. Therefore, I mentioned the issue of the Philips company. We are convinced that it's a matter of circular economy. And it's another type of business when you sell the service of light instead of selling bulbs. So it's a matter of being very practical what you can do. When we talk about mobility, when we talk about public transport, about hybrid cars, electric cars, it's an essential, but then we need honesty. It's not only about having electric cars, because if you are using electric cars and you use the energy from coal plants, that's not really sustainable. So you must be honest in your analysis and how you measure things. So it is about rethinking consumption. What I notice among young people is that they are less interested in the property of things, but more in the use of it. You can see it with cars. Let's say if you are living in a city and you have difficulties of parking your car every day and you can use public transport, then it's much easier to use green wheels if necessary. When we have a lot of mobility in the labor market, you can see now in the United States, I think when you're 37, the average maybe is more than 20 jobs you've had. That also means that there's big chance that you will not live in the same place. What does it mean for the property of your house or renting house? So I have the impression that among young people, the whole idea of the property or the use of things is changing. So we have to be very clear about the different perspectives for the future.
And then one final question before I turn it over to the audience. You referred to the Millennium Development Goals, which of course will expire in 2015, just next year. What's your assessment about the chances that the successors to the Millennium Development Goals will give due attention to this important issue of sustainability? And what are the obstacles do you see to that happening?
You're right. We've had the Millennium Development Goals, and that was the perspective till 2015. So now it's a matter of what shall we do afterwards. I already referred to Paul Polman of Unilever. He's also involved in issues around sustainable development goals. So you already can see there are a lot of discussions about it. I think it's necessary. But what we've learned from the experience with the Millennium Development Goals is we must be very practical in realizing it. And that keeps me busy. And we have made progress in some fields and other fields not enough. So when we talk about sustainable development goals, it is a matter of being very clear in what you should realize. Let me make a connection with the role of the private sector. I think sustainability is high on the agenda of many companies. But the question is, do you really want to change your KPIs, your business models? Do you really want to realize success and realize the results? And will you be open about your success or your failures? More and more, we will see that type of discussion around companies. And I think it's essential when we talk about the next step after the MDGs is to be very practical. And we cannot wait too long. Therefore, I was a bit dissatisfied with the documents I mentioned today. But for me, in any case, these are a source of inspiration to do more. And that should be on the agenda of the UN and so many others.
And then, actually, I can't resist one final question from my side. Knowing what you know now about sustainability, is there anything you would have done differently when you were in office?
I think the discussion now about sustainability is not comparable with, let's say, 10 years ago. Let me give an example. Companies, and it's now about reporting about your financial figures. In 2000, in fact, it was a traditional way of reporting. Within 10 years' time, you could see a change. So, talking about energy, when I became Prime Minister in 2002, from time to time, we spoke about energy in the European Council. At the end of my time when I was Prime Minister, we spoke about it every time. So you can see the changes. we've had the discussion about Copenhagen. It was very important that we could say we have a sustainability summit in Copenhagen. Now we must be able to show success. But let's be honest, the results were a bit disappointing. And I've learned from that. So you must prepare things in the right way. When I was prime minister, we started with an initiative that was called CSR Netherlands. We started transparency benchmark. We have the Dutch Sustainable Trade Initiative. When we took our measures in 2008, 2009 to strengthen the structure of our economy, we had a clear focus also on sustainability issues. And that's what we've done. Of course, you always can do more. But I've tried to give you an overview about how the climate was in those days and what we've done. And now I have another responsibility.
Well, let me open it up to our audience. And if you could just raise your hands, we'll have a roving microphone. And just your name and institutional affiliation.
I'm a first-year student at LUC, Leiden University College The Hague, and we also study global challenges, including sustainability. You just talked about the change in mindset you have in the private sector to be more sustainable and the role government has in helping the private sector being more sustainable. What about the role society has and the role the consumer has on the private sector? What you see lately, especially in the clothing industry in the Netherlands, is that the pressure of the consumer makes the private sector change its way of producing. Do you think that the government should guide society in being more sustainable? No. Or should society guide government on the road to being more sustainable?
This is an excellent question. And I think this is also the key element in the discussion about sustainability today, because you can see the change of policies of companies. That's about integrating sustainability in business model. You can also see that governments are busy to change their views and orientations, the way of working together with others. And we have a strong civil society sector. I think you can see progress. But the role of consumers and individuals, that's really key. And in some domains, you can see changes. You're exactly right when you talk about the selling of clothes. Is child labor involved or not? And I think you have a difficulty in this country if you would try to sell clothes that are made by the hand of children. That's one. The second point, we are talking more and more about the quality of food. When there's too much fat in it, then you can see there's a lot of criticism. Also, you have but this has to do with tax measures. The selling of cars in the Netherlands. If you have a not fuel-efficient car, you get difficulties as an importer or as a car dealer. So you can already see changes, but I think we need much more. There are also a lot of examples that consumers are paying the lowest price. And we have to change that orientation. And in fact, there is a common responsibility of consumers, the role of social media, but also there's a role for the companies just to inform people about what they are doing. I was happy with initiatives that companies are talking about their products, give information. I'm happy with the initiative of young people, as I said, true price. What is the true price of a product? And if we are busy with, let's say, transferring costs to next generations, that's not an honest price. So therefore, I think we need much more the role of consumers. And it's true, the Paul Polnareff, he made a nice remark about Egypt. He said in 17 days, the regime had to disappear because of the role of social media. And he says, if I have difficulties with one of my products, it can ruin my reputation within 2 days. That's also the power of social media and consumers. And companies should be aware of that. And therefore, it's a matter of having the right information, talk about it, also consumer actions. So therefore, I fully agree with this important role of consumers. But this is the most complicated one, but you can see progress. So there's hope for the future. Thanks.
Good afternoon. Khalid Ahmed Chaudhry from International Human Rights Commission. Mr. Balkanende, I hope you can recall our discussion during Martin Luther King lecture. I was extremely provocative, extremely critical of the days of your premiership in regard to Afghanistan, Iraq, and other things. But now I have a different, and I still appreciate, I mean, your decency, your patience, your fatsunlakhai. I have a question. While we are talking about global justice, sustainability, Dutch government signing and the Dutch companies signing MOUs with repressive regimes like Myanmar, like Libyan Libyan government at the moment after Gaddafi's regime, a Libyan government which is at the moment involved in torture, extrajudicial killing, incarceration, crushing their opponents, and the West, Netherlands, supporting business and all other things there. And you mentioned about IKEA. Do you think there is any honesty while purchasing products from third world countries at a very low level, 5 cents perhaps, and selling it here at $10, 10 euros, and then we are talking about balance of the honesty and sharing the shared values and all other things. So don't you think that Netherlands should take into consideration whenever you are signing MOUs and dealing business and sending companies to those countries which are repressive and violators of the human rights to avoid that? Thank you very much.
It's good to see you again. when you're there, there's always the guarantee that we can have a nice discussion.
It is. Thank you.
So thanks for your remarks, and it's also for the way you are you're asking your question in an open way, because it's good to have a good debate on these issues. And I agree with you, when you are talking about MOUs, you have to understand the consequences. And let's be honest, there are many regimes in the world that you have a lot of difficulties, that's true. I remember the time when we spoke about Myanmar. I think it was one of the few heads of government of Europe who criticized the representative of Myanmar, and that was a meeting between Asian heads of government and European heads of government. There is progress now, but of course there are still difficulties. And when you're talking about MOU, it's always important to talk about the role of sustainability. That's exactly the reason why we had a meeting with the Dutch government to talk about, for example, trade missions. When our king and queen or the prime minister or other ministers are going to other countries, usually they are accompanied by trade missions. And we said, when you have such a trade mission, integrate also the element of sustainability. That's one. Second point, I expect from companies, even when they are doing business in difficult countries, as you're mentioning, it's also their responsibility to talk with their counterparts about these issues. That's exactly the reason why a company like Philips, together with other companies in China, is involved in the issue of the labor conditions for people, for the workers over there. Of course, when I was prime minister, I went to the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games in Beijing. I was criticized for that, but I said, no, I will be there. I have good ties with the president and the prime minister, but I always have been speaking about human rights, the situation in Tibet. And you also can see that the Dutch, we have a legal shop for people that they can use legal expertise, even to have proceeds against the government of China. But the Dutch are respected because we have an open relationship, we are critical when necessary, but also you must be honest about these issues. So therefore, you cannot change the world from one day into another, that's true. But you have to be aware of the sustainability components. That's a matter of honesty. And if a company has a nice story, but if it would ignore the difficulties in the countries in which they are acting, then you get difficulties. That's a matter of transparency. So it's a matter of making progress. And therefore, we need this type of critical debate. I think it's very good if companies, when they are talking about their business model and their results, it's not only an internal affair. Talk also with the critical NGOs about your way of doing business. That's exactly what I refer to. The effect. When you talk about, let's say, defining your business goals, it's a matter of participate, as I mentioned it. Talk also with critical NGOs about your business. It's not so nice because you can have difficult meetings, but it will sharpen your views and it leads to more honesty. And therefore, I'm happy with your remark, despite the fact it's critical. Hope to see you next time again.
Yes, sir.
Hello. the distinguished speaker, it's a pleasure to meet you. First of all, I'd like to thank the Hague Institute for inviting you and for allowing us all here. I have three questions. I hope I'm allowed, if I may start. I have the proposition. You mentioned sustainable development and sustainability in general. I was wondering what you think of the use of hemp, for instance, as a sustainable replacement for cotton and other products in, for instance, construction. My second question is on regards to the internet. What do you think is the role of internet in transparency, specifically perhaps the use of the budgeting or other costs more clear and available to all of us? And finally, as following from my colleague there, in regards to pricing, we mentioned that it's, well, it is important for companies to take the responsibility of choosing right and choosing sustainable. However, smaller companies, particularly in the crisis that we're today, are quite squeezed in between, well, profits and prices. So it's quite hard for them to actually sustain. How can they, well, take those choices when they don't have much of a room to maneuver? Thank you.
Excellent questions. I have 3/4 of an hour now. First, talk about alternative products. I can agree, because you always have to think about a new way of producing things, produce things another way. So you have to talk about alternatives. I think that's necessary. That's a matter of innovation, new techniques, etc. So that is a matter of creativity, doing things another way. And we can give many examples. That's one. Second point about internet. I think it's essential to talk about the role of internet when we talk about these issues. I made a remark about concerns about what's happening on internet. NSA, etc. What happened with Chancellor Schröder in Germany, for example. But it's much more than that. Traditionally, you had an army of one country, another country, and they were fighting to each other. Today, you can ruin a country when you would, if you would be able to ruin the internet system. That's what's on agenda today. I had a meeting with some professor at Erasmus University, my university where I'm teaching. And it was about, one was the role of the media towards agenda setting in politics, and the other was the role of social media. Let me make a remark about the social media. The professor said, the risk of social media is that we see a fragmentation in all kinds of issues, because democracy is in fact about the integration of different interests and making choices. It's about setting priorities. The famous prime minister, a social democrat, Mr. Drees in the 50s, he said you cannot reach everything, and in any case not at the same moment. But when you have, let's say, all the issues on your agenda, and that's the role of social media, the question, how do you make choices? What about priorities? That's a risky fare. Having said that, social media and internet will give much more information. And that's also about honesty. That's what you said about some countries. We know the information. Nobody can say, I didn't know it. No, no, that has changed. So that could be an advantage. So if you want to realize more, the world of internet is there. When I'm attending companies in the Netherlands, of course, how are you following social media? All companies are at this moment aware of the role of social media. And it can be, it can threat your business. Sometimes it can lead us to difficult results. One-sided approaches, a lot of fragmentation, but also can be helpful to do the right things. So it's not a black or white scheme. Then your last remark about, for example, the SMEs. I've been talking about the Dutch Economic Growth Coalition. I also said some I made some remarks about CSR Netherlands. What I notice in this country is you can see differences. 60% of the SMEs are busy with issues around sustainability. When you talk about family businesses, it's even higher. I have about 90% is involved in sustainability issues, and you can understand why. Because family businesses traditionally have a long-term orientation. It's not about your income or your bonus, no, it's about creating the conditions under which your children and grandchildren can go on with the company. It's not the focus. You can see differences, but also there I am hopeful, but we are not there. The point is, there has been a time that people talked about sustainability issues when the economy is going up, and when the economy is going down, then the attention faded away. The challenge now will be to do the opposite, to do business another way, and that you can consider sustainability as a stimulus to do business another way. What I notice among young people in cities, you can see a lot of projects. I'm also chairperson of the International Advisory Board of Rotterdam. And it's a group of city development specialists from Singapore, from the United States, from the United Kingdom. And if you would ask those people, we had the meeting in May, what kept you busy most? What was the most inspiring thing? That were the meetings of young entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs, cultural entrepreneurs, startups in Rotterdam. And these younger guys had fantastic stories to tell about sustainability. And that gives me hope in any case. What are you doing?
Right now Wish you a lot of success.
Good.
So my name is André van Heemstra, Global Compact Netherlands. Mr. Balkenende, you rightly spoke, I believe, about the importance of alliances. And if there is one real, beautiful example of the power of alliances, it is what we have been creating in the European Union. Nevertheless, yesterday we were all surprised by the publication of the fact that at this moment in time, 55% of Netherlands people in the Netherlands are in favor of leaving the European Union. I know there was a condition attached to which was not spoken about too loudly. How do we deal with this kind of nonsense?
I think you and I are on the same line. It's a bit strange. I'm also a historian, I'm a lawyer and historian. When you are analyzing European history, and it was terrible what happened in the 20th century in the first part. Never in history we had such a long time without wars in this part of the world. That's one. After the terrible consequence of the Second World War, it was a matter of building up your economies. And in fact, we have seen a lot of progress in this part of the world. Economies really were doing well. We had a separation in Europe between East and West, communism and the market economies. It has changed. I was there on the 1st of May in 2004 in Ireland, and I could see the tears of the heads of government because they really felt at that moment that they were part of the European family. Europe is a continent of values. And the strange thing is we are not aware of all these advantages of European integration. We take all these advantages for granted. And then we are criticizing the things. Let me give some remarks. When the financial crisis started in 2008, I remember very well, and I was prime minister, people said, let's be glad we have one currency in Europe. Suppose we would have all these different currencies, the situation would have been terrible. Let's be glad we have one currency. And of course we have the situation of Greece. But it's really an advantage. How can you have a single market and a big consumer market and then with different currencies? But now it's all attacking the euro. And in fact, it is nonsense because it would lead to huge consequence if we would say, let's stop with it. Also for a country like the Netherlands. We are not a small country, but compared to, let's say, the UK, France, or Germany, we are smaller. So we are dependent on international cooperation. Our future is in Europe and in the world. Otherwise, you can forget it. That's a bit of point. But despite that, it's all negative sentiments. And of course, if there's too much regulation or administrative burdens, okay, be my guest. You have to talk about it. And we need the issue of subsidiarity. What should be realized at the European scale and what about on a national scale or decentralized level? We can have that type of discussion. But it's a bit strange that we are not talking about advantages and we are not talking about the risks. So it's a kind of populist sentiment. And you can see many, many parts of the world, populism and nationalism, and that's a very risky affair. And that has nothing to do with global justice. And it doesn't only count for, let's say, European countries. I spoke with Colin Powell when I was in South Korea, and of course we were talking about what happened in U.S. Congress. You can also see the blocking between the two political movements, Democrats and Republicans, and you can see the Tea Party. And he said, well, Colin, what's your opinion about the function of democracy and function of U.S. Congress? Jan-Peter, you mean non-functioning. And in fact, what we are seeing now in Europe, we see these populist tendencies, but we do not understand the risks of throwing it all away. That's really remarkable. That's one. The second point, if you are convinced that issues have an international dimension, you need international solutions. When we talk about climate change issues here in Europe, when we talk about the energy policy, we need each other. When we talk about having a fair working economy, we need each other. And that's a bit strange just to talk about national sentiments. You will not find the international solutions that are necessary. My third point, you can see there is competition worldwide and is changing every few months. In the beginning, it was rather stable. We had the Industrial Revolution and it started in Europe. Then it was the United States and then it was Japan. And later on, we saw new developments, the emerging markets. Asian tigers, the BRIC countries. And more recently, we were talking about the economic opportunities in Africa. And last year, you can discover that in countries like Poland or the Czech Republic or Slovakia, there are new investments. It's changing every day. And now suddenly you can see that countries like Turkey have difficulties. In fact, things are going very rapidly. And if we want to keep up our economic opportunities in this part of the world, then we have to fight for it every day. I think there's not a sense at the moment in Europe, not a sense enough in any case, about what's necessary to be competitive. I think too many people in Europe believe, well, we are a rich continent and that will stay in this way. That's not the case. You have to fight for it. And if people would have the idea that you only can work on your own, you can forget it. We will lose the possibilities of European cooperation. So I really hope that this attitude will change. And it's a really a risky affair. Last remark. I always believed in an international-oriented Netherlands. And it is a matter of work in the sphere of development cooperation, supporting the work of the UN, the European Union, etc. It's also being active in other parts of the world, even in Afghanistan. You can criticize, but you have to be in other parts of the world. It's about the business sector, that you can find business people everywhere in the world. It's about having ties of universities in other parts of the world, that you have exchange programs for students. It's about tourism. All these elements contribute to having an international orientation. And that makes the Netherlands strong. And I know one thing for sure. If we would stop this orientation, it will harm ourselves. And when we talk about global justice, I always liked a country like the Netherlands that we were fighting for realizing global justice. It can be difficult, but that's your responsibility. So I must say we are on the same line when we talk about populism and nationalism. That can never be the future.
My name is Toxel Peyes. I have one question. I would like to know something about one sector which you did not touch upon, I think. You mentioned many companies that you had contacts with and which positive developments were taking place. But what about the banking sector, which actually created a lot of difficulties, which we are now in? And I don't think we can go back to what it was. But how positive are you about the creation of a new banking sector, very important for all these developments in the coming time?
Yeah. It's a very good question. I'm not satisfied about the financial sector when we talk about sustainability issues. Let me refer to Peter Bakker. He made a nice remark. He said, accountants will save the world. Of course, it's not about accountants, it's about honesty and being transparent about your results. You can see the changes of the business strategies. That's the reason why you can see progress in many fields. But he says banks should do more. That's one. Second point, if people from the financial sector would think, and you can see it now in the United States, the profits are coming back. The bonus system is coming back. And when you are talking about, the situation of those financial institutions, yeah, they make a lot of profit. But the question is, what have you learned from what happened in 2008. It's about integrity in the system, transparency in the system, because these banks can have beautiful profits. But the states, many states, have very high debts at the moment. They have huge consequences. And a lot of people are suffering because unemployment went up. That's the consequence. So I think the financial sector should be aware of their responsibility. In the Netherlands, I think the situation is a bit different because we have a bank code and there's more integrity in the system. So more positive about, developments here than what you can see in the Anglo-Saxon world. But if we want to find solutions, for the issues that are on the agenda worldwide, we need the financial institutions. And what I see in the Anglo-Saxon world is much business as usual, going back to the bonus system as we had before the year 2008. I think that's your remark, and I agree with that. We need more creativity. We need the financial sector also to find solutions, but also a more ethical self-reflection. And that's what I do not notice in New York and London at the moment.
Let's take a final question.
Mr. Balkenende, I have a very simple question. and I would really appreciate an honest answer. We are all surprised about the rise of populism. In your opinion, are you satisfied with the way the politicians today explain to the people why we should stay in the EU? Are you satisfied with the way they do that? Do they do that often enough? Do they do that clear enough?
The fact that populism has a chance is already the proof that it's not going well. Because otherwise, we would have another orientation. And the problem is that a lot of people think, well, populist arguments are easy. Nobody's talking about the consequences. So I think there should be a better explanation, but also to have a right dialogue and talk about the consequences. It's so strange that people are just talking about, let's stop with the euro, without talking about the consequence of that. Some people are saying, well, let's have a euro and a zero, a North European euro and a South European one. It would have enormous impacts also on our competitive strength. I'm happy that the situation calmed down. When I was in Washington in 2011, I spoke with Bob Zurek, he was president of the World Bank in those days, and with Olivier Blanchard, the chief economist of IMF. And both said, oh, Greece will disappear. They will leave the eurozone. And you know what might have happened. Greece out, and then Portugal, and Ireland, everyone knows it. It's a risky affair, so I'm happy that the situation calmed down. It's in our interest. And therefore, you have to explain, but also you must have the right dialogue. And at this moment, I think much has to be realized. That's actually your question. So I agree with that.
Ah, well, we'll take a final one. I see you've already...
Yeah, I already saw that question.
So that'll be the final question.
Thank you very much. My name is Oke Uche. I'm a lawyer from Nigeria. And I'm very happy being in this presentation. One thing I noticed is that the talk about sustainability is sort of focused on tying it to profits. It's better you apply principles, it will improve your, you know, earnings. And I have a question. What if the issue is really justice? And what if you respond to the justice and you're a company and it throws you out of business, what are you going to do? And whose responsibility? Let me give an example. In the US, for instance, you talk about property rights. If you find oil in the back of your house, it belongs to you. In a country like Nigeria, if you find oil in the back of your house, it belongs to the government. But the risk of exploitation belongs to you. You know. Now, laws have been made quite all right, you know, to, if I will use the word, expropriate the oil from the citizens to the hands of the government, and no compensation paid to those citizens. And on the other hand, the government, which is a community, does another transaction with, let's say, an international oil company, and they exploit the oil, but the local communities are left with the consequences of that. And when you check the justice is how do we compensate those communities? And if in compensating them is going to add to cost, why none of the companies doing it for sustainability?
That's a complicated issue. In my speech, in my contribution, I made a reference to the book Why Nations Fail. And I used the argument that it was the necessity to have inclusive institutions. When you talk about natural resources, there's also a question, who can take benefit of these natural resources? And in some countries, it's a matter of the government. In other countries, it's a matter of the oil companies or elsewhere. And it's a matter of having a fair share for everyone. In this country, we are producing gas. In fact, it's also the question, what shall we do with the gas? The criticism is, during the past, that we've used it for paying things in this country, even Social Security. Now, it has changed because we worked with the idea you should invest it. So we had a discussion about what about these revenues of gas. In my opinion, it always must be a situation that lots of people can take benefit from that. And then you need the role of governments. Of course, private businesses must be able to do their business. And also you have to talk about the perspective for people. These things must be in order. You must have the right balance. And if you don't have the right balance, then you get the difficulties. And that's what you can see. If it's only a matter of, let's say, oil companies that are getting everything without taking into consideration the role of ordinary people, then you get, in fact, the extractive institutions. So that's a matter of being fair. And it's not an easy issue. So therefore, it's so important that also oil producing companies are talking about what is their role towards society, what is their business, what about their local communities, how about the cooperation with governments. These issues are very complicated, but it's a matter of working on the perspective of inclusive institution. I think that could be an answer for finding solutions.
Well, it only remains for me to thank you very much, Mr. Balakanand, for being with us today, for your insightful remarks, and also for the candor with which you've responded to the questions which have been posed to you. I'm also, on behalf of all our colleagues here at the Hague Institute for Global Justice, very much appreciative for the kind words that you've had to say about the Institute and the potential role that we can play in making the world fairer and more sustainable. So thank you very much for being with us today. And I should also like to thank the audience for coming to this event. And please join me in thanking our speaker. And you're all invited to a reception next door where you could engage with Professor Balakanand.